Good afternoon, everybody. Here I stand upon a tree surveying the domain that is Juma and Arethusa to the west of us. We are looking for Sandile, the young 20-month-old leopard cub, son of Shadow and perhaps Tingana or Mvula. We're not really sure at this stage. You're on a live safari from here in the northeast corner of magnificent South Africa, and you're most welcome. It's a joy to have you with us this afternoon. It's a kind of chilly-ish 21 degrees Celsius, 70 degrees Fahrenheit, which for us in winter is, well, it's quite cold for the middle of the day. Anyway, my name is James. On camera today is Brian. Hello, Brian.
Hello, James.
AKA the Gobbling Turkey. Very nice. On the other vehicle, we've got Brian, at least Byron, being filmed by Wim Doornbraak, the diminutive form. He is starting to resemble Paul Kruger again, and that is disturbing for all of us in camp. Now, Sandile was in here, off to the west of me, this morning. It's very, very thick in there, so we can't just kind of go driving in there hoping he might be in the same place. It's highly unlikely he would be because he was left moving. We'll do a quick sort of circumnavigation of this block. We've done most of it already, and then we're going to head off east towards Cheetah Plains. I think Byron is going to head off towards Mvula and see if he is still around where he was this morning. Now, when I say you are live, that is precisely what I mean, and it means you must please talk to us during the course of the afternoon. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to tweet, like the Birchall starling that just flew overhead. That wasn't me falling out of the tree, mercifully. It was a piece of bark. Hopefully there is no scorpion there to sting me on the hand. Otherwise, you can talk to us on the email, questions@wildearth.tv. You can send us comments, questions. You can even send us queries about Africa, South Africa, and anything else you'd like to know about this fine land in which we find ourselves.
Well done, James. Well
thank you. Thank you, Brian. Well done. Very nice to climb a tree, I have to tell you. And I would advise it. In fact, if you're feeling down, feeling blue, feeling a little bit under the weather, as it were, stand in the sun and climb a tree. Well, maybe a low tree. You don't want to injure yourself. And I think you'll feel better. Right. Let's go and see around the corner and see if we can find Sandile. While we do that, Byron has got a little rat-like carnivore to show you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the afternoon drive. Thank you, James, for the introduction. This afternoon is myself, Byron, and Wim on camera. Hi, Wim. We are in the area where we had a male leopard this morning, Mvula. We just wanted to come and see if we could try and find him. The day has warmed up tremendously. It's a beautiful afternoon, and I think he's moved off into some shade. We've had no luck yet. But we have found something very interesting. Have a look straight ahead in this burrow, right in front of us. You can see some beautiful dwarf mongoose. Look at that. They've been scurrying around foraging, looking for insects and food that they could possibly feed on. And these mongoose are very gregarious, always in large family groups. And the dwarf mongoose can reach numbers of between 10 and 20, sometimes up to 30 mongoose in a family. Another mongoose species in the area, which is also very gregarious, are the banded mongoose. They're much larger. These are the smallest mongoose we have, but they are very, very cute and wonderful to watch. They are so relaxed. They're just running, scurrying around right in front of us. Look at them go. You can hear a woodpecker tapping away in the distance. But how fantastic is it to be able to sit with some of the smaller creatures? And this morning we had a lot of elephant around. So from the elephant all the way down to the mongoose, there's always something happening. What we'd like to do is just check around this area a little bit more and see if we don't have any tracks of Mvula. Maybe he has gone and lay down, as I mentioned, in the shade somewhere, and we just need to look a little bit harder. It's quite thick around here, a lot of gwarri trees around here. Nice shady spots for a leopard to go and lie down. There is a waterhole not too far, just across the boundary. He may also have gone there during the day, have a drink of water. You know, leopards do move around surprisingly quite a lot during the day, more than people realize. And we often don't get to see them that much because they are so secretive, and if they do move around, it is difficult to follow them at times. But this morning he was very relaxed, lay down in front of us, and we spent quite a lot of time with him. But again, you never know. When animals want to move, and as the day warms up, as I mentioned especially, then they will go and look for some shade, especially the predators. Lion and leopard love to do that. A few mongoose still just scurrying about. What Viam and I are going to do now, I think, is head back towards the road to see if we get any tracks of Mvula walking through or crossing the boundary. Dina, thank you very much for your comment, mentioning that I have found some animals before James again this afternoon. I must be honest, I've been very fortunate, I think. You never know what you're going to see in the bush. And when you do find something, it makes it a lot easier to do this and to speak about something. James is far more experienced than me. Link, I think let's just go have a look what James has got.
Just below that one, Brian, just below. Everybody there. Nope, down left, left, left. Sorry, everyone, there's a green-winged pytilia in here. It's just, keep going down a bit. There, you got him. Down, down, there, there, yes! That's the green-winged pytilia, the Melba finch, everybody. Beautiful, beautiful bird. Isn't that stunning? I don't think we've ever seen one of those. And to the viewer that very kindly congratulated Byron on finding animals before me, well, in your eye, I say. There's nothing behind there, is there, Brian? Was that just wind moving the leaves?
I'm not sure. No, I think it's
not Sandile cleaning himself, perhaps. I don't think it is. Hang on a second. if there's a leopard back there, I will be utterly astounded. Let me just keep looking, everyone. Just enjoy the sight of that green-winged pytilia. And say green-winged pytilia a few times. And blue waxbill, of course. Thank you, Kirsten. It'll be enough from you. Brian, have you tried to say green-winged pytilia?
Green-winged pytilia.
Doesn't that feel good? Mm. Now, the male is the one that we were looking at. Those are the blue waxbills. Oh, there's the leopard just behind you, Brian. Right there.
Oh,
Brian, there's a leopard. He's right there. To the... just the other side. This is the best day of my life. Male and female green-winged pytilia, two blue waxbills, and a leopard. Very nice. Let's turn around. And to the viewer who congratulated Byron for finding animals before me, in your eye, double fold. May your eyes be watering with shame. There is Sandile, everybody. That's who we were looking for from that rather ridiculous log, just crossing into Juma. And I think looking for his mum, definitely in his old hunting ground. This is exactly where his mum used to leave him when she used to go foraging. Exactly around here in this corner. You can see this, you saw the signs on the road up ahead there. Now this is the corner between Arethusa and Juma and Hoffman's to the south there, basically in the direction where you're looking now. He's heading straight on to Juma at the moment. Let's just keep with him. Oh, he's so lovely. If he carries on this direction, he's going to, if we are, he'll go south across the boundary. I actually can't believe we just stopped there. And there he walked past us. Let me get round him, Brian, before you twist your back clean off its hinges. And there was obviously that leopard behind the birds there as well, wasn't there, Brian? Yes. At least three or four. A pride. There he is. What a stroke of luck that is. I just thought I'll come do one quick turn around here. He definitely hasn't caught anything since this morning. Oh, I just wanted to tell you, while we watch him walk, this is a bit distasteful, so I hope you haven't just had your lunch. But when Viam and I went back after we left you this morning, we left him and he had just vomited. I don't know if you remember, but he just vomited on a termite mound, and we went and looked. And in the middle of the vomit, which was deeply disgusting, was a huge tapeworm. Now, I think that's pretty normal. These animals all carry various strong parasite loads, especially the cats. And so I think all that was, well, I mean, maybe that's why I was vomiting, but I don't think he's any more infected than anyone else, but it was very interesting to see. Let me move a little bit forward, get a slightly better view. See how he avoided the road? He came onto the road just to kind of cross it, but he walked next to it. Oh, what a joy. And you can see there, he's sort of hiding from the road almost. Ah, now HK, you're a new viewer. Wonderful to have you with us. Thank you for your question. You ask a very valid question. What on earth is that collar on the leopard for? HK, the collar is on the leopard because he has just come back from rehab. Now, I know that sounds completely ridiculous, but it is true. He's just come back from a rehabilitation center where he was put because we thought he had rabies. He caught a rabid dog at one stage about 7 months ago, and he was inoculated and put in quarantine, and now he's just being monitored. So that collar will fall off in a little while, I imagine in probably a month or two, and then he'll be without it. But it's just so that we can ping his whereabouts. Isn't that lovely? What a great view. So, I mean, I know it's not the best to see a leopard with a collar on, but at least we get to view him. And he's got such a story, HK. You know, we watched him from being a tiny little cub, and then he killed this dog on his own. Well, he didn't kill it, actually, but he caught it, and it was found to have rabies afterwards. And that was horrible. And we thought he was going to have rabies, and we'd watched him, and we'd enjoyed him for so long. And then it turned out that he didn't have rabies, and they brought him back. Much bigger than he was when he left, of course. He's now 20 months old, and he's still in his mother's territory. He wouldn't ordinarily be independent at this age. Wonderful. So Tim in Arkansas, I'm going to have to give a bit of background before I answer your question. You say you were obviously watching during the TV special we did, and there was an unbelievable sighting, everybody, of this little fellow reuniting with his mother, who's already got another daughter. And the fear was that he would try and kill the new daughter because, of course, infanticide by unrelated male leopards to cubs is enormous. It's a huge risk. It's the greatest killer of young baby leopards. And she didn't seem to want anything to do with him. That's the mother. she seemed to think that he was a real threat, and she was making a big sort of threatening noise to him, and she was shouting at him and then chasing him. And Tim, it's my considered opinion that she was it's my considered opinion that he wouldn't have harmed that cub. I might be wrong. I don't think he would have harmed that cub. But at the same time, remember, just before he left, that's kind of how she was treating him already. So your question about whether or not she was treating him in the same way that she would be anyway with him being this age, I think is valid. I don't think quite yet, because it's unlikely she would have given birth yet. I think she's probably sort of 3 or 4 months early. Now, she did come into estrus before he left. We know that. And so it's possible that she would have had a cub by this stage anyway. But the males normally don't go independent before sort of 2 years. So he would be going independent now. And that's how she would be treating a male leopard cub just before he went independent. Maybe not with quite such aggression, but she would certainly be trying to distance herself. That said, it wouldn't be unusual to find her and him and the youngster on a kill together. Scott used to mention many examples where he saw that happen with a young male leopard, her mother, his mother, and another cub, or the cub from the next generation, feeding together. And that's before the male becomes independent. Now, he will only become, well, he's independent now, but he will only become territorial probably in about 3 years, when he's about five. A very fine fellow he is. Yeah. Well, very good question from Wendy here, and one that's not that easy to answer with a straight face. Wendy, you say, we always go on, we bang on about the fact that we don't like to interfere with these animals. And why is it then that we interfered with Sindilo? Why didn't we let nature take its course, or why didn't we just destroy him? And the answer, Cindy, is for this, in this particular case, is a fairly simple one. It's simply because the dog would not have come onto this reserve had it not been for human intervention. So, I mean, the human, it was a rabid domestic dog, and a rabid domestic dog, of course, is an anthropogenic effect, and therefore we interfered. So we won't interfere unless we won't interfere if an animal is injured normally. So we had Quatila, who was bitten by the snake, and she died, and we didn't interfere with her. But he, of course, killed a domestic dog, which is a human effect, extraneous to the wilderness, and that's why we were prepared. That's why we were prepared to interfere. I hope that answers your question. But there it's a grey area. Absolutely, it's a grey area, Cindy. And there were many, many people who called for him just to be destroyed. And destroy, of course, is a horrible word, but basically to put him down, because he is a threat, or he was going to be a threat. And then the guys on the tourism side, or some on the tourism side, were saying, well, we don't want a leopard here with a collar on it. We don't want our guests taking pictures of the leopard with a collar. And I think sense has prevailed in this particular case. It hasn't been done before, where a young male has been reintroduced into his mother's territory. And I think this is a fascinating view on what's going to happen. And I think the real tester was on Saturday, when Brent had him with Shadow and the new cub. And we thought he was maybe, you know, he's much bigger than his mother now. He could have pushed home an attack easily if he'd wanted to. And I just don't believe he did want to. That's it, everyone. He's gone on to Hoffman's. We'll just get a last view. He might cross into Arethusa. I don't think so, though. No, he's heading, you know, almost heading in exactly the direction that he did, or that he was heading this morning. But he could easily come back further to the west. That's to the right of where he's moving now, and on to Arethusa. So we can't go where he is now. Wasn't that a beautiful sighting? I just cannot actually believe our luck there. Stunning. Nice one. Well done, Brian.
Well done, James.
Let's go across to Byron. He's on Arethusa with no animals.
And look at it. As I said, yeah, it's always nice to find animals. And next thing James finds, beautiful birds to show you, and then a leopard as well. And I was just saying, you know, James has a lot more experience with this than what I do. And he doesn't need to have, or doesn't need to see animals to entertain you. I'm still learning and trying my best, but fortunately I've got James to chat to after drive. He always gives me some friendly feedback, which is fantastic. So we're on Arethusa at the moment. Viem and I are driving around in search of anything really. The tracks of Mvula actually crossed our boundary and they headed off in this direction of Simabili. Just as I thought, he was heading over towards that waterhole. You know, a warm day, leopards do need to drink, and he possibly went to go and have a drink of water and find a cool spot to rest in that area. Been seeing a few impala around while we've been driving. And I'm going to try and head towards a larger waterhole a little bit later. With warm days like this, after a few cool days, you might get quite a few animals coming down to drink. Some blacksmith lapwings. Here's a small waterhole right here. Let's see if we have any activity or sign of animals. No. Nothing just yet. So a lot of elephant dung. This morning we had quite a few elephant heading down to the water to drink at the Vuyatela waterhole. I think this looks like a spot where elephant. This spot looks like a nice spot for elephant to come down and drink at. Nice and open, but easier for them to get down to the water, splash themselves around. It looks like there was a bit of activity here sometime early this morning. Looks like a bit of water that has been splashed up just on the edge where that elephant dung is. So I'm sure there was quite a bit of activity. X-Ranger has asked, or X-Ranger, I'm not sure if I'm saying that correctly, has asked me what the strangest thing is I have done to entertain guests. He mentioned that Steph had drunk some water from elephant dung. That definitely is up there, I think, with one of the strangest things. I've not done that. And what I'm trying to think of, the strangest thing I've done to entertain guests. I have dressed in, this is a squirrel. Oh, there he goes, just up into the knob thorn. Let's see if he comes around again. Little tree squirrel just ran in front of us and up into the tree. Big acacia or knob thorn, big acacia tree. Very sharp thorns on it. The squirrels climb them, and very easily, I might add, and then often will nest inside the holes in these trees. Looks like he's hiding from us. So back to the strangest thing I've done for guests. We occasionally have seen some guides, and I think especially in the 70s and the 80s, the guides were, it was a time where Africa was wild and untouched, and I think a lot of the original guides were a little bit like that. They They would, I'd like to think they were a little bit more manly than we are today. They used to wear short shorts and really short shirts with cut-off sleeves or torn shirts. It was a rugged time, and I tried to impersonate some of these guides for my guests, and I found some really old shorts and cut them really short, and had a tight shirt, and it just provided them with a number of laughs more than anything else. But I haven't really eaten anything, or I've had mapani worms. We get mapani worms on a mapani tree out in this area, usually in summer, and dried, most people do eat them in Africa, and I have eaten a few mapani worms in my life, but nothing too hectic with anything else for guests, now that I think of it. In a beautiful drainage line at the moment. It's a nice area to also look for potential leopard activity. Also, you might get elephant moving through areas. Lovely sandy riverbed. I find this would probably flow or gather a little bit of water when you have lots of rainfall in summer. These dry riverbeds, they generally don't hold water at all through the year, but if you have floods or heavy rain in a short period of time, then you will get little pools forming in these water holes. Love driving through these riverbeds. Oh, there's a beautiful tree just off to our left. Have a look at that. Really large, tall tree. This is a leadwood. It is part of the Combretum family. And this is one of my favorite trees. Really, really beautiful. An incredibly hard wood. And this wood is used often to make fires, and is a very, very, it's a very popular wood to use for furniture and as I said, for fires. And because of its hard texture and very hard wood, this tree makes beautiful coals. So if you are out in the bush and you're making a fire and you get a dead leadwood lying around and you're able to carry, because it is quite heavy, and you manage to get some branches onto a fire, you get wonderful, wonderful coals from it, and it's great to cook on. Often these trees can live up to 500 to 800 years. Sorry, yes, 500 to 800 years, which is a very long time for a tree like this. I have seen dead leadwoods that we have tried to ask and get more information about them, but some of them stay standing for up to 80 years, 80 to 100 years after they have died. So they really are incredible, incredible trees. They've got beautiful branches. A dead leadwood with a sunset behind it makes an incredible photograph. So that is one of my favorite trees, a leadwood. Good afternoon, Gracie, and I understand you are Jada's best friend. It's lovely to have you on the show with us this afternoon. And Gracie has asked what my favorite animal is. And Gracie says she likes hippo and elephant. Oh, there's another little dwarf mongoose that just ran off. So, Gracie, my favorite, I've got two favorites. And just like you, elephant is one of my favorite. I love elephant, and it's been fantastic to drive around in the last few days seeing the elephant activity that we have. And one honey badger. I haven't seen a honey badger for a very long time. I see that there was one spotted at one of the waterhole cameras recently. And I'd love to see a honey badger. And they are one of my favorites. But as I said, I have not seen one for a long time. Thank you for asking, Gracie. This is the warmest afternoon we've had in the last few days. It's about 22 degrees Celsius, 24 degrees Celsius, so just over 70 degrees Fahrenheit. It's a lovely, beautiful winter's day. Quite a bit of bird activity here. I'm just trying to see if we can, it's a little bit tricky. I don't know if VM will be able to pick up on it. There was a crested barbet. I think it's a bit difficult to get through there. Just flew off. Oh, bird party. There's some arrow-marked babblers I can hear calling. Let me see if I can get that sound for you quickly. Let's see, they've just stopped calling, obviously. Why don't we cross over to James and see if he has got any updates, and VM and I will continue our search for some more wildlife.
We don't really have any updates. I just wanted to tell you quickly though, everybody, other than the fact that there's a virtual starling sitting gloriously in the sun over there. You see it, Brian?
I do see it.
It's not a virtual starling, is it, Brian?
No.
It doesn't have a black eye. Yes, it does. It's a virtual starling. I should be able to identify those at 700 paces at this stage of my career. We found Karula's tracks, or a female leopard's tracks, going all the way up the access road today. I'm pretty sure it was Karula. She had a drink at the pan at 10:30 last night. And then more tracks now heading down south. They didn't look very fresh to me. But if she's wandering up there and she's coming down here, she might be coming on soon. So we'll come back this way when we come back from Cheetah Plains. At the moment, we're heading off to the Far East in search of Singapore noodles and cheetahs. Do you like a cup of Singapore noodles?
Yes.
Have you ever had Singapore noodles?
I haven't.
Nor have I. I've just read about them.
And?
Apparently they're very good. Yeah. I'm glad Byron is exploring Arethusa. I think what he should do is probably keep an eye out for Shadow's tracks. I wonder if that little leopard that we've just seen isn't going looking for his mum and his little sister. There's a very cross bird in here. The birds get cross seemingly for any reason, not necessarily because they're leopard cubs in the tree. Now, I do have a confession to make, everybody. That way, while we were incredibly lucky with that leopard, we probably could have seen him earlier. And while we were looking at the birds, I went back around there just to look behind that bush where I thought, you know, there was something moving, and there wasn't. But his tracks come straight down the road, and the only reason that he was off the road when we saw him was because we were parked on the road. So while we were all focused in on the birds, he was obviously coming dead straight down the road towards us and then moved off the road to go around us, which I think is quite amusing. Anyway, Brian and I were just saying again that we are of the opinion that while we like to think that we're tracking these animals, more often than not, it's absolute blind luck that gets us to see them. We'll take it. We'll take it any way it comes. All right, we're going to drive a little bit faster now on our way to Cheetah Plains. I think there's a question from Soft Cat, is that correct? Soft Cat? Fox Hat, not Soft Cat. There's a rattling cisticola in that little tree there. Can you see it there? Just in this little thorn bush. Far right hand side. I don't want to move. There it goes, flying away It's go. Oh, there's something else. Well done. Now, soft hat. Or fox. Okay, Kirsten, go again with that. Fox hat. Hello, fox hat. Well done. Now, that's a rattling cisticula. Fox hat. You say, what is the biggest animal that I've ever driven past without seeing? Unquestionably, a 6-ton elephant bull. I think I have driven past a 6-ton elephant bull standing just next to the road. I was probably waffling on about something on the right-hand side of the road or looking out of the door for tracks or just daydreaming. I've definitely driven past an elephant within, probably 5 meters of the vehicle, so 20 feet. We've all done it, some more than others, of course, but we have all done it. That is the best picture of a rattling cisticula that you'll ever get. Now that's the bird, everybody, that does get very cross indeed when it sees a leopard, and it goes and it's that that gives it its name, the rattling cisticula, because although I didn't sound like a rattle there, it sounds like a rattle. All right, let's go back to Byron for an update. We're going to speed across to Cheetah Plains.
So, well, James is heading across to Cheetah Plains. Myself and VM are still in search for some wildlife on the Arethusa site. No luck just yet. We've had quite a few elephant tracks in the road, so we might be lucky and bump into an elephant or two shortly. They do look quite fresh, so from this afternoon sometime. But it's just such a beautiful afternoon, and I find often you can just get lost driving around, enjoying the sunlight and the sounds and the smells of the bush. Doesn't matter what you're seeing, but it's just got an amazing feeling. It's a feeling of calm and peacefulness. Got a few flies around us at the moment. And a big hello to Gordon, who's watching all the way from the UK. I understand Gordon is coming out to visit us sometime soon. So I look forward to seeing him out in South Africa, taking him on a safari. How's it, Gordon? Velma, good afternoon to you. Velma has asked if I've ever participated in a poo spitting contest or dung spitting contest. I have, and I won, Velma. That's I have indeed. I suppose, okay. Now getting back to that other question, now that I think of it, that's probably one of the craziest things that I've done for guests is we have stood and try to spit dung, impala dung that is, and seen who can spit it the furthest. Yes, I have done it. I think most of the guys, especially the ones, we've all done it. Anything for a good laugh. Again, we're just on the edge of a small drainage line, just off to the right. See if we get any animals hiding in the shade and the cool drainage lines. Really fantastic in these warm afternoons, especially in summer when it's so hot. Get a lot of activity of animals moving through those areas. you a similar question this morning about the leopards. In a year,
and Byron has lost his signal. I don't know why that is the case, but hopefully it will come back very soon. We are now at the entrance to Chitwa, which is halfway, or most, in fact, it's most of the way to Cheetah Plains. Now, very seldom have I ever taken you into Cheetah Plains. Only when we get there do we come over. And I want to show you the very special tradition that I think Brian and I developed. It was you and I, Brian, wasn't it? Yes. Now, you've got something very special coming up, everyone. Not really. But there will be maybe some light amusement. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. Good, how's it? Are you Lauren Hoffman?
No.
Okay, that young male leopard walked on there.
Oh, really?
No, yeah. But he might come, he was coming southwest, so he may well go on to Arethusa.
There's some Indian global.
Brilliant. Okay.
The whole day going back and forth.
Super.
I got an update about Shadow.
Yes.
Youngster on safari.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, Byron's there. I'll give him that update. Okay. Yeah, cool.
Not entirely sure. Just
okay. Cool. Lekker. Thank All right. You very much.
Thank
okay.
You.
Enjoy your drive. Bye bye, everybody. That's Peter from Coral, everyone. Now, I'm going to ask Kirsten to tell Byron to get an update there on Arethusa. I don't know if you heard Peter say there, but Shadow and Cub seem to be around there. So with any luck, Byron will be able to go and have a look. That would be very exciting indeed. So we'll get Byron to have a look there on the radio and see if he can get into a sighting. So that's Peter from Coral. So the lodge is out here in the western, or the eastern sector. We've got Cheetah Plains where we go, and Coral is just to the north of that. And then Chitwa, which we've, the entrance to which we've just gone past. Torchwood is this reserve to the north of us. We're not allowed in there at the moment. And that's where the Nkuhuma lioness has got her little cubbies. And hopefully soon she'll bring them towards Biffleshook Dam and we'll be able to see them there. Right here. It always feels like we're going on a really nice exploration along here. I love it. I did nearly drive off the road though, of course. Still black screen for Byron, I'm afraid. Sorry, I'm just listening to the radio. There we go. Now the landscape and the geology of this area is generally fairly uniform, and so that's why, I mean, were we driving along here on Juma or not on Juma, you wouldn't really notice the difference. It's only once we get down south into the midst of Cheetah Plains that the landscape does change, and that's because there's a bit of a soil change, which is lovely. And just gets a little bit more open. But otherwise, everything is precisely as it would be on Juma. Right, here we go. Ryan, are you ready?
I'm excited.
Are you excited to reveal our little tradition? Here is the Cheetah Plains sign. Now, what you have to do for luck is go around the circle twice. That's once. We'll go around it once more. And then we go on to Cheetah Plains. There we go. Well, everyone, everybody. Lael, you're in Washington and you're wondering that when we're off, when we're not on on live, when we're kind of away, are the cameramen on break or are they on constant standby? Brian, when we link to Byron, what are you going to do?
I'm going to be on constant standby.
Yes.
Ready for action.
Ready for action, constantly on standby.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yes, sometimes. What they do is they lock the camera off in the position that it is now, and that means that if we have to crash cut, like we had to come very quickly when Byron lost signal there, if you had to crash cut to us, at least there's something to look at. Hopefully I won't be saying anything too untoward, and nor will Brian, but basically that's how it is. There's a little bit of taking it easy, but the cameramen are also massively important for looking for animals. It's all very well just one of us looking, but I can only look at one side of the road at a time, and certainly the cameramen are an enormous help looking for tracks and spotting stuff. And I'd say, certainly as far as my game drives are concerned, at least 50% of the stuff that we see is the cameramen. Especially actually when we live, when we're driving like this, I'd be staring at the lens. Brian's not actually operating the camera at the moment because there's not a huge amount for him to do. It's locked off, so he's looking into the wilderness. He might see a leopard or a cheetah or something like that while I'm looking lovingly into all of your eyes. Now, this is the driveway. Nkoro's on our left. Chitwa Chitwa on our right. It's all rather confusing. And if you are a first-time viewer, or perhaps a newish viewer, all of these names might be slightly confusing to you. We are part of the Greater Kruger National Park, of course. In fact, we're part of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, which goes all the way north into Zimbabwe and east into Mozambique. And all of these lodges and names that I'm mentioning to you now are part of the Northern Sabi Sand, which is a collection of private game reserves here on the western fringes of the Kruger National Park. Byron has managed to find himself some signal. I hope he finds himself Shadow and her cub very soon as well. See you shortly. Shortly.
Sorry about that, everyone. We seem to have lost you there for a second. And just getting back to the question I was asked earlier about a leopard and how many or similar sized wildlife they're able to kill in a year. It's a very, very difficult question to answer because we're not entirely sure. It depends on how successful the animal is, on the area, how much wildlife is around. And I'm trying to think. I would guess a big full-grown male leopard, successful male leopard, possibly could kill maybe around 40, 50 impala in a year, give or take. But again, it's not always easy. There are a lot of variables that are taken into account. Get an update on Shadow and her cub, and apparently there were reports of her crossing over into the area this morning. No one has managed to find her yet, but there are a few guys having a look around, and if they do have an update for us, we'll definitely see if we can see her off. This is a complete new area for me, so I'm learning as we go along. Luckily, I've got VM with me, and if I head off in the wrong direction, he'll just give me a point left or right. A lot of elephant tracks in this area again. Some really fresh elephant tracks here. Let's see. Oh, there we go. There's an elephant. Ah, look at that. That is great. There we go. I thought so. Very fresh elephant tracks on the road here. That's always nice. If a guide manages to see a few tracks, and if they do look fresh, if he finds the animal, that's a big bonus. And he is down in a bit of a drainage line. So as I was saying earlier, it's nice and cool down there. There's a lot of green vegetation. Water table in that area is probably a lot higher, so the trees that do grow in those areas do need a bit more water. So there's some good vegetation for that elephant to feed on. Looks like an old bull from what I can see. Oh, that's interesting. Have a look at that ear. Yeah, see how that ear has been bent? The left ear is folded over, and that can happen at times with elephant. It might have been or might have occurred at birth, possibly bent ear from birth, and it has grown up like that. I've only ever seen it from birth with that defect, with that deformity. With the ear, it doesn't really affect them. They're still able to flap it and cool themselves. You can still see the veins very clearly in the back of that ear. Just hiding in the thicket there a little bit. I understand some of the viewers have seen this elephant before. So it obviously moves around this area quite regularly. Knows that there is water and good vegetation around here. We were discussing that this morning about whether or not the animals are intelligent, certain species, and especially elephant and their memories. And have they got good memories? I'm almost certain that they do. And I think this, with this elephant being in this area, we have just passed a small water hole, but there is a bit of water there. It obviously knows that there is water. And I think it is a sign of their intelligence and their memory. They know where to go, where to find water. They know where the water holes are, the good vegetation to feed on. Incredible animals. Well, I'm glad we got to see him. He's moved off a little bit further into that thicket. Let us continue and see what else we can find along the way. Sorry, this is a dead leadwood, which I was speaking about earlier, with that beautiful alive dead leadwood that you saw. But look at these branches, how they stand out. They've just got such character. Seem quite ominous. Beautiful tree. As I said, for photography, if you're photographing a sunset or a sunrise, it's fantastic to see. Now, Riley asked how long these trees usually live for. I have read that they can live up to 500 to 800 years, which is a long time. But when they die and they stand like this, apparently, and again, I've read this up and try to do as much research as possible on them, they can stay standing for anywhere up to 80 or 100 years after they have died. Very, very strong trees. Especially one this thickness. This is a very old tree. Very, very old. Lovely. Nice to see it. Beautiful bark, thick stem. In the area, lots of sign of elephant around here. Some impala. Let's see if we can maybe get a glimpse of them just off coming out of the drainage line. Can you all see that? There they are. Look at that. Sounds like James has got another elephant. Why don't you go and have a look at that for a while with him?
Hello everybody, we're on cheetah plains, obviously. You saw us drive here, and there is an elephant. He's probably about 25 years old, I would say. Not quite in the fullness of his adulthood, but he's eating some fairly noxious stuff. That's the stuff that Brent ate for the first time last year, and it made his whole mouth go numb, because in typical Brent Lear Smith style, he put a whole fistful of those leaves into his mouth, and he was unable to speak for about half an hour. And that's because the tannin in it is so very strong. And the fact that that elephant is eating it, it's called Gymnosporia senegalensis, or the red spike thorn. And the fact that he's eating it indicates to me that there's not a great deal else to eat. You know, elephants, I think, are much like human beings, different builds. He's quite stocky. He's not very tall, hey, Brian?
Yeah.
And I've seen some very tall elephants of around about the same age, I reckon, that are not quite as stocky as he is. I'm not sure why he's opened his ears out like that. I think he's definitely not listening to me. He's a very peaceful fellow. Now, we're not too far from three in a row pan, or trifecta water, Brian. Triple H2O. It's just around the corner, so let's carry on there. I think he might be heading that way. We're also hoping, of course, that quarantine is lurking about at three in a row pan. I've yet to see him there, but every time Brent goes past, he seems to be lurking around there. So let's just go around the corner. Some impala in there. I'm not going to stop to show you because they're too far away. This is quite strange weather. It looks quite sunny, and it is sunny, of course, but it's really not very warm out here, which is unusual for our winter's days. As I said to you from my perch at the opening of our little show today, hello, Joey in Australia. Nice one from you. You say, on a scale of 1 to 10, how astounded would I be if I was to come across a sable right now? Joey, I'd be about 9.5, I reckon. I know that they are possible to see here. I know that there have been one or two bulls seen here of late, especially closer to the Kruger boundary, but I wouldn't expect to see one. So if I did see one, I wouldn't sort of fall out of the car, but I'd be 9.5 out of 10 astounded. It would be really great. I'd be very excited indeed, Joey. Brian, would you be excited?
Very excited.
Yes, you see. Joey, I'm sure it's night time where you are. Or very, very early morning. Please tell us, Joey, where, I think you have done this already, but please tell us where in Australia you're from. There's some buffalo up ahead, a giant herd. Well, 10 or 12. And when you've done, and an elephant in front of them. This is wonderful. And also, Joey, just when we, as we're getting into the sighting, tell us how many hours different you are from us. It'd be great to know. There, the buffalo. It's not a giant herd, it is a herd. And an elephant bottom disappearing in front of them. I just don't want to stop just yet. I think there's water in the pan up ahead. So there are three pans here, hence three in a row pan. And there are three elephants. Gosh, this is a rare joy. I'm just going to stop here and let them get in front of us. I'm not going to disturb them too much because we can't really get around them. So let's just them get past the second pan. Isn't that great? Isn't that a wonderful sighting? Animals everywhere. I don't see quarantine anywhere, do you, Brian? Not yet. Quarantine, everybody, for those who don't know, is a 3.5-year-old leopard. Son of the great queen, Kurula. I'm just going to ease forward here and see if there isn't any interaction between the beefaloes and the heffalants. Buffalo don't... Oh, one elephant is getting a little testy. Oh, this is going to be great. How's that, Brian? Isn't that wonderful? Riley, a nice one from you. How do you tell the age of an elephant? Because I said you want to know how old that elephant was that we saw. Riley, an elephant can be aged basically by his size, and it's very difficult otherwise to age him other than experience. You can see from the size of his... Oh, those elephants are backing off from the buffalo, which is unusual. So, Riley, from the size and from the build of the elephant, you can tell. But otherwise, it's not very easy. And it really does depend on the experience that you have. So your experience around elephants makes a huge difference. Well, the elephants just backed off. They don't muck around when they're drinking. They don't take a huge amount of time over it. Elephants. Aaron in Florida, you say, how do elephants not have a nose burn when they suck water into their trunks? Aaron, I'm assuming you mean because like with you, if you try and snort some liquid into your nose, you will get a nose burn. Aaron, I don't rightly know, other than to say it's probably got to do with the fact that they're used to it. You know, their noses are their nasal passages, the sniffing organs and the sensory organs and the turbinates of the nose are up in the skull, same as they are for us, and they don't often sort of suck the water up that high. So I think that would be the answer, Aaron. That is a good point. You see how these guys are not mucking around either. I mean, they've had their quick drink and now they're off. And they're following exactly the same path as those elephants did. Maybe they know something we don't. Or they've decided that this water isn't great and they're going to head up towards another waterhole. That was a rather short and sharp drink, wasn't it? It wasn't quite the spectacle I was expecting. There they go, and you can just maybe hear them as they walk through the bush there. I think the colour there is stunning. Golden green, especially in the sun. Following the exact path that the elephants did, I think that's fascinating. I wonder why. They're not eating the same things at this time of the year. Buffalo almost exclusively grazes, and elephants at this time of the year really are browsing more than anything else, eating a lot in the way of bark and twigs and wood. You feel that wind, everybody? I know you can't feel it, but you might be able to hear it and then feel it on your face. Janet, you want to know why this is called a pan, or not a pond or a dam or something like that. A pan, Janet, is basically a natural depression of clayey soil that holds water. So this is an artificial pan because it's pumped full of water, but the clay base underneath it allows it to hold water, and that's why it's called a pan. I'm not sure of the origins of the word, but a pan is basically a natural depression that was once probably just a mud wallow, so it was a puddle, and then a warthog came and rolled in it, and then maybe a few warthogs, and then maybe a buffalo, and then maybe a rhino, and then maybe some elephants, and eventually it becomes a big thing like this. Oh, there are a whole lot more buffalo behind us. Look at that. Here we go, here come the old men, everybody. A whole lot more buffalo coming down to drink. Let's see if they have a drink. hunt. Here they come. Come on, beefies. Come and have a drink. These chaps look a little bit nervous. And you can maybe hear the elephants in the distance going. Some of them are not going to drink at all. Now that to me is unusual because buffalo have to drink, especially when it's dry like this. I wonder why they aren't all going to drink, and I wonder why they split up like this. I think it's quite strange. You see them just wandering about, not knowing whether to follow the herd or to have a drink. And you can maybe also hear them belching. You can hear them. Very nice question from Aileen about the leadership role or the leadership in a buffalo herd. And Aileen, you say, I often talk about the fact that elephants are led by matriarchs, and you want to know who leads the buffalo herd. How does it work? Aileen, it works. There is a separate hierarchy of males and females. It's not a strictly enforced hierarchy, though it's kind of informal. And, I mean, there's no real advantage to, you know, a female buffalo being the leader. So what tends to happen is it's a sort of democracy of the oldest females that decide where the herd moves. And yeah, there's no outright leader. They don't fight each other at all. The males fight for dominance, as they do in just about every mammal and reptile and bird species, but the females likewise tend not to fight with each other. And when we talk about, remember, we talk about two matriarchal societies out here. We've got, of course, we know about the elephants and we know about the hyenas, and we talk about them both. And when we talk about hyenas, that matriarchal society is absolutely enforced with violence, and it's enforced with, it only changes with violence and with death. And it's enforced normally at food or at the den site. And with elephants, that is completely different. It doesn't ever occur like that. Elephants do not fight with each other for dominance. It's just the biggest and oldest cow that takes on the responsibility. I always think that's quite interesting. So although we say that they're both matriarchal societies, they're actually maintained and enforced in a completely different way. Hello, Miss Jacobs class in Illinois. It's very good to have you with us. Thanks for joining us. I'm not sure how old you are, so I shall just talk to you in precisely the same voice as I would talk to Brian, for example. Miss Jacobs class, that white under the eyes that you are wondering about is caused by oxpeckers. Now, oxpeckers are those birds that eat the ticks and other ectoparasites off an animal like this. They pick at the ticks. Not because they like ticks, but because they like the blood that the ticks get at. And ticks are in great profusion, or there are lots of them under the eyes, because, of course, as you know, under your eye, if you feel under your eye, you can feel that there's an opening, there's moisture there. And so there are always ticks there. There are ticks in the nose and ticks in the tail and ticks anywhere where there might be an opening where they can get easily at soft skin and suck out the blood. So the oxpeckers are those birds, and they then go and pick off the ticks, and that in turn leaves them sort of bald. It's like a callus almost. A callus is a piece of hard skin that constantly gets rubbed. And your heels, I'm sure you kids run around without shoes on every so often, your heels at the end of the summer They've got calluses on them, and that's the same kind of skin there that occurs underneath the buffalo's eye. Lovely to have you with us, kids, or teenagers, or whatever you are. Let's go and see if we can find something on the plains of Cheetah Plains. While we do that, let's head across to me old pal Baron. There is the sun, everybody. Let's go across to Byron and see what he's got at Arethusa.
Thank you, James, my old friend. And it is great that he was able to show you all those buffalo. It looks like James has got the luck this afternoon. VM and I are still driving around and we have not seen too much. Trying to see if we have any tracks of any predators or any animals for that matter. Anything that we could potentially show you. What we have been enjoying though is this beautiful sunny afternoon. Especially with these winter colors in the bush at the moment. The reds, the oranges, the green, yellow, beautiful coloration in the leaves, and it's just so beautiful in the sunlight. This afternoon is fantastic. Really, really warm. Please don't forget to send us your questions. If you're emailing us, questions@wildearth.tv, and on Twitter, just hashtag Safari Live and send us your questions, and myself and James will hopefully answer most of them. Ah, another vehicle. Afternoon. Hello, how's it going?
Hi,
how are you?
Staying
out of
trouble.
Good, man.
Yeah.
Good. Where is
that in Danyang? I'm not sure. I'll see you a little bit later.
Cheers, man. Thanks a lot. Cheers. Ryan is, looks like he's lost all his guests, so he's not having a great afternoon. I'm just joking. He is on his way to go and collect guests at the moment. What a small world. Ryan was actually at school with me many years ago. He was 1 or 2 years below me at school, but I recognized him as soon as he drove up. I didn't actually know he was a guide in this area. It's incredible. It's amazing how you can bump into people in the middle of nowhere that you know. So Heidi in Switzerland would like to know how it feels on one of my first drives with you and in front of the camera. And great question, Heidi. It's interesting. It's such a different feeling. Now I think this is my fifth drive for Safari Live. I did two drives last year and then I've been back since yesterday, so this is my third drive with you for this particular stint. And it is a very, very different feeling. I must admit, the first two drives, and especially in the beginning, as soon as I get out on the vehicle, the nerves and the butterflies go. It's incredible. I mean, I've been guiding for 7 years, almost 8 years full time, and for some reason, it's different when you've got guests on the vehicle. You feel more comfortable, you've got that interaction, you can speak to them and they can ask you questions quite quickly. Yeah, it's a completely different feeling, and still getting to know the area and all of you and the viewers, and I love it when the questions come through. It's really fantastic and it makes it a bit easier for me. Oh, there's some elephant up ahead. Look at that, straight ahead in front of us. Just shows you, you never know what you're going to see and bump into. Let's see if we can get a bit closer. So thank you for that question, Heidi, and keep sending more questions in. I hope you're all enjoying having me with you so far. I've been seeing some of the comments, and thank you very much for all the kind words from some of the followers. As long as you are enjoying it, I'm happy. Oh, it looks like a nice herd in front of us. Good afternoon, Helen. And Ellen, thank you very much for your question about elephants. And Ellen would like to know if elephants sneeze, and have I ever heard it? Have a look. Yeah, they are right off to the left. Looks like quite a large herd in this area. Number of younger elephants. I think I saw one or two babies moving through, or calves, just in front of us and off to the side. This is a beautiful herd. Let's sit tight here for a few minutes. I think they are going to cross over in front of us. Getting back to Ellen's question, now that I think about it, yes, I actually, Ellen, I have heard an elephant sneeze, and I've parked very close to one and had one sneeze on one of my guests. And so, it's a funny story. It's a guest of mine, and we have been on many safaris over many years. For about 6 years, we've been doing safari together, and we got quite close to an elephant bull. And he came and he sniffed around, and he did sneeze, and there was a little bit of liquid that came out too. Nothing too serious. Have a look. These elephants are coming across in front of us. There they go. Oh, wonderful. Look at the youngster lifting its trunk to the adult. So Guru's asked, I'm just going to move a little bit further forward quickly. Guru's asked about elephants' memories and how they remember where the water holes are, for one. And we know that they do. And if some water holes, some of the man-made water holes in certain areas, if they are closed, what happens to those elephants? Where do they go and look for water? So just hang on a second. There's one right close to us. Elephant just next to VM, off to the left, just hiding in the bushes right here. So the elephant will know where the water holes are, and if they are closed or if there's no longer water being pumped into the man-made ones, they will go into dry riverbeds. They often dig for water, and they will find other places, and they definitely communicate with each other. Elephants do communicate with each other, and they will let each other know where there is water. We don't necessarily understand. Oh, look at that youngster playing. What has he got there? Little, what is that? Oh dear, let's go have a look. It looks like he's got a jersey or something. That's interesting. So they will definitely find other means of water. They'll dig in dry riverbeds. They'll go to other water holes in the areas. Elephants aren't territorial, so they'll cover huge distances to look for water. But they will definitely find water in other areas. Playful youngsters again, off to the right. Hello. Oh, isn't that fantastic? I am loving all this elephant interaction that we're having at the moment. It has been fantastic the last 2 days. Oh, look at that. chasing one another. They're completely relaxed with us being around them too. Over the years, I'd like to think I've got reasonably good at understanding elephant behavior and interaction and their warning signs and whether or not they are happy and comfortable with us being around. Again, I think it takes a bit of time to understand and witness different behavior from these animals. But generally, elephant are fantastic because they do give a lot of warning signs if they are not happy. These elephants, when elephants are feeding and playing, they are generally very relaxed. Oh. And that's a young one trying to show off a little bit for us. Often the younger elephant will try their luck and they test us. They're not too sure what the vehicle is. They're still learning. And they're trying to show off. And I think, again, it goes along with that playfulness. If you have a look, these younger elephant are quite robust and they try and push each other around. It's incredible behavior. And wonderful to watch. Beautiful afternoon light too coming through the trees. As these elephants walk, they kick up the sand and the dust. You see these little dust clouds drifting off in the sunlight. Incredible scenes. I'm still curious as to what that elephant had in its trunk earlier and what it was flicking around. Right, let's go see. I think James has got more elephant.
What are you on? Everybody, we've come to this water hole here called Cheetah Plains Pan, and well, Brian is attempting his, or showing his remarkable skill filming the crowned lapwings fighting, it seems, with some blacksmith lapwings. Well, now they're just fighting with themselves. Wonderful stuff here in the clearings. There are elephants everywhere, believe it or not, and there are also a wonderful herd of zebra just thinking about coming down to have a drink. They've stopped there because the elephants, which are just, it's a whole big group of bulls that Brian's going to show you quickly. There they are. There was a big herd of, you know, a normal herd, breeding herd of elephants wandering off into the thickets, and then there's a big bachelor group. That's an unusually large bachelor group of elephants. Big one in the front. You can see there's one big bull with his big tusks there who seems to be leading the crew. Now, he won't have a formal leadership position, but he's just showing them the way, I guess. And they're sort of trailing after the herd, which went sort of trotting across, well, not quite trotting, but running off into the thickets to have a meal. In fact, you can see some of them having their supper. Isn't that great? Just very pleasant sitting here in this golden sunlight. And I think the air is so crystalline, so beautifully crystal clear, is because it has been, this cold front has come through here. Because of the cold front, the dust seems to blow away and we get this stunning, stunning light. I must say, we have been richly, richly blessed today with wonderful sightings. Let's not forget the one we had of young Cinderlai. Really very peaceful and special out here. And this, everybody, is why one would want to live in the wilderness, away from the seeming comforts of a city life. It's just too pretty to be here. I don't know if you can, well, you can't feel it like I said to you, but you can certainly maybe hear that there's a gentle breeze blowing out of the southeast. And that's where our weather generally comes from. And that's basically the direction you're looking in. You're looking southeast. The clouds have moved off, and I think it'll probably be a very cold night tonight, but I think tomorrow we'll be back to those still sunny middays. You can see how skittish they are about coming to drink. They're always nervous. All herbivores are nervous when they come to drink. We do know that lions, for example, will concentrate around an area like this because they know that the herbivores, especially the zebra and the impala, have to come and drink. So lions, cheetah, I'm sure as well, will kind of keep an area like this in their peripheral vision and might even lurk around in the bushes on the periphery, and that's why they'll come a little bit closer, stop, look, smell, come a little bit closer, stop, look, smell. They'll be a little bit unnerved by the fact that we're here, but we're a good distance from them, so I think they'll probably come up. Now, let's just try and check the order of them there. Three, it should be the oldest female in front and the stallion behind. They may have spread out a little into this clearing, and the stallion, you might find him at the front with his first wife. No, he's at the back there. He's way at the back. Yeah, that's him there. He's just turned his back to us, and in front I think the oldest mare, unless there's a little bachelor group following the kinship group. See, I mean, they're a highly water-dependent species, and yet they are nervous. Well, Paul, you say you wonder why the lions don't just camp out near the pan. They know the animals have to come. Well, you're right, Paul, and they do to a certain extent, but they also, well, they don't know, but the animals learn very quickly, and that's why these zebra are wary. They know they've seen predators here, but they're prepared to come and have a drink simply because they know that the lions are not always here. Now, were the lions to always be in this area, they'd never come back here again. It would be far too predictable. So although we tend to think of animals as being a little bit gormless at times, they will very quickly learn what's going to get them killed and what isn't. So I've no doubt they've seen cheetah coming wandering past here. I've no doubt they've seen lions coming past here, wild dogs, leopards even. We had Inkanyeni in a tree not far from here the other day, and wild dogs in the same sighting. Unbelievable stuff. Now that's why they're just a little bit reticent to come and have a drink. There are the elephants. That's the big bull, and he's just giving a bit of a shove. Liz, a nice question from you, and the answer is yes. You say, are ostrich as difficult as cheetah to find here? Are they as elusive? They are, but then they're as elusive for the same reason. So in some parts of South Africa, for example, you'll find ostrich all over the place, and that's because the habitat is ideal for them. Drier areas than this normally, more open areas than this. Places like the Karoo, which is a semi-desert, semi-arid area in the center of the country, up into the Kalahari. Did you see lots of ostrich in the Kalahari? Some.
A fair amount, yeah.
More than here, for example. So Brian used to work in the Kalahari, which is in the northwest of South Africa, and there are far more ostrich than there are here. And I think you'll find there are more cheetah there than there are here as well. And that's just because it's more open, it's easier for them to catch things, and so that's why they live there. And this is the only real, well, this is this particular area going down into Malamala to the south of us, is the only real area with open areas that suit ostriches and suit cheetah. And that's why we don't see them that very often. Tasha, nice one from you, and you'll read and hear various different things around this sort of thing. You say, does the brown on the zebra mean that they are younger? No, it doesn't. Some have got those brown shadow stripes, some simply do not. Some will tell you that it's a regional thing, others will tell you that, it's got to do with age, it's got to do with sex. I have found it to be completely random. So some will have those brown shadow stripes. I suppose the closer you get to this area, so this is the northern reaches of the sort of this particular, it's not subspecies, but say race of Birchall's zebra, they will have more obvious shadow stripes in this area possibly than they do down in the Cape. But no, they're not, it's not necessarily, it well, certainly isn't an indication of age. Righty, I'm just going to... And Donna, you say we have wonderful memories of the zebra birth. We do. I must confess they're slightly tinged with sadness for me, because I don't know what happened to that little baby zebra that we saw being born. I'm hitting my mic. I'm sorry about that, everybody. I'm just trying to retrieve something. There we go. Can you hear me? Is that all right? Is that fine? I'm just walking. Marvellous. Good. Jean-Rose Busby. Hello, Gracie, aged 8. I'm glad you told Byron that you and I are best friends, because I don't want him to be your best friend. I want you to be my best friend only. And you say, how many wives does a zebra have? Well, let's count them, Gracie. It's normally 3 or 4 if he's a big mature male. So there we have all the zebra here. Let's count them first. All. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. Now, there's some youngsters there, 1, 2, 3 or so youngsters. There's the big stallion, I think, is the one that's facing us now. No, that's a mare. Right, so those two on the right there, Gracie, I think one is an old mare. I think one is a slightly younger one. Might be related. Then if we go to the left of that, we've got a mare and her foal. That's it. Well, maybe not a foal, actually. Grace, it's very difficult to tell. Now, those are two mares, and then to the left of that, and then another one. So I think, Gracie, he's got 4 wives, and I'd suggest that the rest of them are youngsters or young ones that are probably a year or two old. It's possible that there are 2 little families here, Gracie, but I don't think so. I think it's 1 family. And what they're looking at is another family coming towards them. And I've just, there they are. Look at them coming through there. This is fantastic. So this is a much smaller family, Gracie. Just the 3 of them, I think. Oh no, there are a whole lot more coming behind. Lots and lots. So that's the lead, that's the oldest female in front. Definitely a female. And bringing up the rear, or the back of the group, Gracie, will be the stallion, will be the daddy. And you know why he walks back there? He walks back there because if they're going to be attacked, it's normally from behind. So something like a lion will chase them from behind. And he's the biggest and the strongest, so he will then help or protect his family. What a very, very good sighting we're having of all these zebras. Marvellous. Right, I think let's move on, everybody, before the light fades too much. Unless we just see the meeting here. Let's just watch the meet. So I think there might be a bit of a meeting. A standoff. A standoff at the pub. A little bit forward, Brian. Now, zebra, we know, everybody, are not the nicest creatures to each other. They can be a bit mean. ease forward here. See what they do. I think this is probably three groups of zebra actually coming through now. This is fantastic. You know, it's so often so tempting to move away from an area where you see that there's nothing here. So often it's worth just having a sit and waiting to see what's going to happen. Here we have all these zebras. You can hear the Senegal lapwing going. Also the crowned lapwings going. Oh, we can see elephants coming down here as well. In fact, there's a huge elephant coming up just behind us. It's going to reverse slightly. A big fella coming out of the sun. Isn't that great? The dust coming off him there. Now, Barbara, we look at this elephant bull. You say, can a stray elephant come in on an established herd? No, not normally, Barbara. Well, no, that's not necessarily true. They wouldn't really want to, could they? Yes, they probably could. So, a stray elephant would be an elephant that had lost the rest of its herd. And so a bull wouldn't want to, because a bull would be on his own by default. I suppose a young cow could definitely join a herd if she wanted to. Wonderful stuff. And look who's coming. Look at this absolute behemoth coming across the clearing. Enormous elephant bull coming lumbering across the clearing. He is massive. Huge tusks. I wouldn't trifle with him. Hello, Mumsy in Cincinnati. Thank you for talking to us. You know, how much training does a father elephant give? How important is his mentorship? Mentorship is very important, Mumsy. And, you know, we don't know exactly, but we do know that in areas where elephants have been reintroduced and there have been no big mature bulls, often young bulls will go what we call rogue. And they become very difficult. Ones like the one behind there, they become quite difficult. And they kill rhino sometimes, they kill hippo, they kill other animals. And then if you import big bulls like that chap in front to kind of mentor them through their passage into adulthood, you find that everything turns out okay. Isn't that beautiful? And there goes our friend, all the zebras. I think we're in for a bit of a treat here. These elephants are now going to meet up. The zebra are not going to come and have a drink while those fellows are knocking about here. Let's see how their meeting goes. This could be very cool. That's the sound of a child you can hear calling on another vehicle. The birds are getting upset. This is fantastic. Now, the big bull is waiting behind while the two youngsters meet. Ooh, that's quite angry. That's very angry, in fact. And see how the big one comes in and they back off. This is fantastic. This is just amazing. Isn't that great? So the young chap just had his drink and he's been told to clear off. Oh wow, this is too marvellous. We're very, very lucky indeed. Alright, we will just keep awake here because they might show their displeasure with us. I'm going to move back slightly. Just so that they have space, should they want to come down here. And so that I can drive off frontwards if I need to. How's that, Brian? That is an immense, massive elephant, everyone. Oh, that's incredible. That is too wonderful. Hello, boy. I hate myself for saying that. Isn't he cool? He's so cool. He's so huge. Hear other elephants in the background there. Right. He's quite an impressive fellow. So I would say he stands probably everybody about 9, maybe 10 feet at the snow, 10 feet at the shoulder. I'd say he's probably 30. He will get bigger, he will fill out even more than he is now. This is so wonderful. We're only sitting, everyone, about 10 meters from him, so about 30 feet. And he seems completely comfortable with us at the moment. Let's hope that maintains. You can hear all the Senegal lapwings behind us. There they go, all flying around, and they're flying around in a mixed flock of crowned lapwings and Senegal lapwings together. And this chap seems to be pretty chilled with us. It's too wonderful. And zebra all still there, they're definitely not going to come and try and have a drink now. They'll be much too nervous. James, a very nice question from you, and it's a common one, and it's a good one. Is there some reason you beast of burden in the same way as his Asian cousin is? There are a few good reasons. The first one is that the African elephant, of course, evolved in Africa with human beings. They therefore have a much more natural fear of us, a much more kind of instinctual dislike of us, if you know what I mean, because we've been hunting them for as long as we have been standing on two legs. Now, that means that if you try and tame them, they're more likely to try and sort of knock you down than are their Indian brethren. At the same time, they are also in need of much more food than Indian elephants. They have evolved in an area where the nutrients are poorer in the soil, so they have a digestive system that allows them to process a great deal more food, and they have to eat a lot more food than their Indian counterparts. So that, combined with, I suppose, a lack of need for them out here, I mean, I suppose they could have been used for transport, but they just never have been used for transport. Except when Hannibal, of course, used them to go over the Alps to Carthage, at least from Carthage, interestingly. But those are the reasons. You can use them for beasts of burden. And they are certainly used in, and I know that there's a hugely controversial, you know, topic around riding African elephants. And certainly there seems to be some very bad press about it and its goodness for the actual animal. But it can be done. So you can domesticate an African elephant, but I believe it's a lot more than domesticating its Asian cousin. And they're just listening to us, having a nice drink. Let's see what this big fella does now. He was here when we started, and then he moved. He was the big chap that moved off into the bush, and I said he was mentoring his pal. But interestingly that he's obviously got a relationship with this young bull that he's with, but not with the other one who he very clearly chased off. I think that's so cool. Just the lovely dropping of the water, the sound of them slurping and sucking and not getting their nose burned, of course. No nose burn. I'll sit here forever, quite comfortably. And Heidi, nice to meet you. You want to know, do elephants become larger in the wild than they do in captivity? Heidi, no, I don't think they do. I would say probably the other way around. Simply because if they're kept, well, it really does depend on what they eat. So if they're given sufficient to eat in captivity, if they eat all that they can, I think you'll find they'll actually get even bigger than they do out here. Oh, that's wonderful. I love that sound. And there's the other one going off now. Now he's flapped his trunk over his tusk, and that's often a sign that they're about to come into must, maybe. And I have to tell you, although he looks smaller than the big chap, and he is smaller, he's not much smaller. And this big fellow is really big, but if were you to come across the smaller one outside of the presence of this behemoth in front of us, you'd still be utterly astounded by his size. He's listening to me, you know. Yes. Hear the bird starting up again. These wizened old eyes. The gentle sound of him blowing the water into his mouth. It always sounds like such a slow sigh. Isn't that cool? And now, from the right-hand wing, there come the zebras. There they are. I thought we were going to walk into frame long before they did. Now, I don't know if you can notice, everybody, but you can see maybe that the light is already starting to fade, and it's because the sun is about to set. It's just about to go down, and these zebras will want to have a bit of a drink before the sun goes down. Lovely big herd of zebra. And now, Gracie, if you're still watching, that's two or three different herds that have come together. And often they do that in winter, because because they all like to come and drink at the same time. So I'm sorry everybody about the pixelation. Apparently you can still hear me fine, but all you can probably see is a sort of Picasso-like artwork of what we're looking at now. So there's the elephant having a drink, that's what you're looking at the moment. The zebras are coming around the outside, thinking about having a drink. There are doves, there are birds. It is the most exquisite evening here on Cheetah Plains. Very nice. Not so, Brian? Mm. It's so delightful.
So magnificently splendid.
Splendiferously magnificent, Brian. Mm-hmm. One slow-mo shot with a cell phone.
As one should.
As one does. One mic. Sorry about that, everybody. Right, once we've had a look. Well, in fact, let's do it now. Let's go ahead across to Byron, everybody, and find out what he's got to show you. I think he's still on Arethusa.
Isn't that fantastic, James? All those animals coming down to drink, and there was a lot of interaction. Incredible. It's always fantastic and wonderful to see different species in the same area. We have come back onto Juma, and we are driving around, heading in the direction of Bull's Hook Dam. Hopefully we'll get something down at the waterhole. The temperature has definitely dropped quite a bit since the sun has started to set. And there seems to be a calm and a stillness in the bush at the moment. Not even much bird activity, which is interesting. I think just before they all started calling later, the final calls for the afternoon, it made us a little still patch that we've hit. We are searching, and I'm still learning my way around, and VM's giving me some tips on where to drive and what to look for. Beautiful time of the afternoon. Still this golden light. I think if I just stop through here, if you have a look in front of us, just this little view that we've got. Look at that color. We spoke about it earlier. Beautiful orange, yellow, green, light green. Just a fantastic, fantastic coloration that we are getting from this afternoon sunlight. It's beautiful. No, it's so great to be able to appreciate these types of scenes and the scenery that we are seeing or get to see every day. I really love it. It's so calming and so peaceful. I think we are going to have a beautiful sunset this evening. And I think let's head back to James. Sounds like he's got more elephant for you.
So this elephant is obviously very, very thirsty, everybody. He hasn't gone anywhere. He's still lurking right here, enjoying his drink. The sun is setting behind him. The zebras are much too scared to come and have a drink with him here. And we're just having a wonderful time. Brian and I are sitting here marveling at the golden light, the zebras knocking about the place, the beautiful elephant in front of us, not more than 30 feet away. and he's just drinking quietly away. Very, very lucky, and you can just see, you can see that the light is now faded. It's not so gold over them anymore, they've just gone into the shade, and as the sun starts to set, it really does get quite a lot cooler. They will eventually be able to come down and have a drink, I'm sure. Look at him turning to us now. I'm just getting reports on my radio here of possible lions. I think he's going to move off now. I'm going to reverse very slightly so that you can get a look just before the sun goes down. Well, maybe not just yet. He's too wonderful. He's smelling us. Just deciding if he's ready to move on or not. Isn't that awesome? It's the most incredible shot. Look at the hairs, the dripping water, those unbelievable prehensile tips to his trunk. And prehensile means, of course, everyone, that he's able to use those to pick up individual marula fruits if he wants to. And you can see the two nostrils. That is too fantastic. Now, he's interacting with us, everyone. There's no doubt in my mind that what he's doing is listening to us. He's assessing. And I keep saying this, and I'm going to keep saying it until I'm sort of proved wrong. There's a boredom about an elephant's life, I think. And I think that their interest in social interaction extends to kind of seeing what we want. I guess we're slightly, a little bit of a challenge to him. That's why those zebras didn't come up here. They weren't interested in engaging with an animal this size. Isn't that special? All right, I'm going to suggest we move. I'll tell you why, for two reasons. One, I would like to show you the sunset. And two, I think we're being unfair to these zebra. I think they're not going to come and have a drink while we're sitting over here. And I think they've been waiting very patiently for quite a long time. Let's have a quick look at the sun. And then we're going to move down into the clearings. Isn't that stunning? Hello, Cat and Tampa. You're wondering if the two stallions from these two or three different herds will have a fight with each other. Cat, I think you've only to watch them to see that no, they won't. And I don't mean that facetiously at all. They're clearly not engaging with each other, and that's simply because they're not trying to steal each other's wives. That is the reason that zebra do fight with each other when they're trying to get another female or trying to pick up a new wife. And normally a zebra mare, once she has been not kidnapped, but once she's found her partner, normally they remain totally faithful, and so there's no real point for them to fight. If a young male were to come in here and to try and abduct, they call it abduction, one of the young females, then a stallion might fight. But if it's two sort of settled kinship groups or family groups, no, then they're not going to fight with each other, Cat. They'll just take it easy. Here comes a brave one to have a drink. We could wait here. Let's give it 2 minutes, because we might get an unbelievable sighting of them drinking. But if they still look nervous after 2 minutes, we're going to move on and let them be. Oh, Well, there we go, Bethany. Bethany, you make a very good point. You say when two zebras sit together, it's difficult to tell where one bit begins and the other ends. And you say, could that be an adaptation to making them look bigger for their predators? Bethany, not bigger, but yes, absolutely. I think what it does is make it difficult for their predators to tell where one starts and where one ends. Look at the lovely reflection there. Isn't that special? Beautiful. Another vehicle coming along here. I'm so reticent to start the engine. I just think that they're coming closer and closer and closer, and we're getting such a beautiful reflection there. And they're now watching another car coming. They must be thinking to themselves, when are we going to have the water to ourselves? All right, everyone, I think let's move on. I think we're stopping them from coming to drink. I don't think that's fair. All right, let's head across to Byron and get an idea of what he's doing. Probably still on Arethusa, not sure. You find out.
Yes, look what we have just found. A beautiful lioness lying up at Biffle's Hook Dam. I'm so happy. I was starting to get worried there for a second. Thought James was getting all the attention. how beautiful is this? And just with this last bit of golden light on her face. Have a look at that. Interesting. I don't see any other lions around. It's just her by herself. We can't see her front. I understand that a few guys were asking about these lions in the area and whether or not this female is perhaps lactating. So we can't really see from this angle, and I'm not sure which pride this lion is from. If anybody, any of the viewers, has got any idea, they can please send us their answers, and we might be able to get a better idea of where this lioness comes from. And if we do think she is lactating, which could mean all the lion dynamics are. So Catherine has suggested that this might be an Nkuhuma female. And that is interesting. And again, I'm not too sure why she's by herself. The other day, and this morning in fact, James had lion tracks in this area. I had lion tracks here yesterday afternoon. So there's possibly been some activity around with these females, because I definitely had at least three or four lion tracks around here yesterday afternoon, and I think those were perhaps this female and a few others. It'll be interesting to try and find out. Ah, look at that. Cleaning herself. I'm not too sure if she has gone down and had a drink already. I would assume she possibly has. But you never know. We might be lucky. She might go down and have another drink. Lions tend to drink a lot of water when they can, when the water is available, because they can go for quite some time without any water. Can see those beautiful black tips on the ears. You can see them clearly, and those are all markings that have been put there for a reason, and these lions have adapted to have those markings specifically for a few reasons. One of them, it's the theory is that it's a following mechanism when these lionesses are walking through the long grass and they've got perhaps cubs or other lions following them, they can see the black tip of the tail or the black tip behind the ears, black tips, and they're able to follow each other that way. The other reason is when they are aggressive, they pin those ears forward and you see those black tips very clearly. So it's an aggressive sign. So Roger has asked if this lioness is possibly waiting for prey. Good question, Roger. Yeah, she possibly could be lying out waiting for something to come down to drink. The only thing is she's right out in the open. So the chances of her really having a good chance of hunting anything out here is, are quite slim. Let's have a look as she turns over there. You see those belly? Don't see any big teeth, so I don't think there's a chance of her having cubs or potentially, let's see again, maybe they do look a little swollen, perhaps she is pregnant. Okay, and I've just got an update and I understand that the Unkahumas were denning around this area. So this is possibly this lioness from the Unkahuma pride. So this is very exciting, really great. This is my first lion, I think. Yeah, my first lion that I've seen on Safari Live or while I've been here. So this is very exciting for me. It's always nice to see these new animals. You don't know where they come from. You know, you get to learn a story, and I'll probably sit with James tonight and find out a bit more information about them. So lucky to be able to see her out in the open. I'm so happy that we got to see her. This is fantastic. Wonderful elephant herd earlier, and now this lioness. And as I was saying earlier, we were driving and it was very calm. Very peaceful, not too many birds. Now the birds are all chirping. We've got red-billed buffalo weavers in the nests above the waterhole. And a few other birds calling in the distance. It's like these last calls for the afternoon before the animal or before the birds and all go to sleep. Can see that beautiful torchwood tree in the right hand side of the picture. As VM zooms in a little bit closer, see those big nests on the left hand side of the tree. Those are the red-billed buffalo weaver nests. You can hear the birds chirping loudly from there. They are very social birds, so community nesting birds. There'll be a number of pairs all within that nest. A really, really great scene here. So, Joey in Australia has just asked what one of my most memorable lion sightings have been. I've got one or two, Joey, and one of them, I'll never forget, when I started guiding, we had tracked and found a pride of lions, and there were two big dominant males with these lions. And these males, it was warming up in the morning, it was getting quite hot, and one of the males got up and decided to move over towards the vehicle. And I think he wanted the shade of the vehicle. I've had it a few times, but this being my first time, you know, seeing lions and tracking, finding them, and having these big males close to us, this one male walked straight towards us and lay literally at the footwell of the vehicle, right next to me, in the shade of the vehicle. I must admit, I got quite nervous, and the tracker I was with at the time had a good chuckle to himself. It's one of the vehicles passing us so quickly. Someone from Chile Plains. Also got to see the lioness. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
What I will do is see if we can get another position, maybe on the other side of this lioness, and see if we can get a nice view of her face, the lying down, and then the water off behind her. So Joey, yeah, so that was one of the more memorable lion sightings, and recently I was fortunate enough to see some lionesses hunting buffalo in a riverbed, and they chased the buffalo bull, jumped on his back, and three lionesses were jumping on this buffalo and trying to pull him down. But he was a big, strong bull, and he managed to shake two of them off. And with the last one hanging on, he actually ran into the river. And the last lioness let go, and he ran straight through, out onto the other side, joined the herd, and ran off. They're incredibly tough animals, very, very powerful. So that was another very memorable lion sighting. Let me see if I can reposition for us quickly. Keep an eye on this lioness so long. I'm just going to drive around. See if we can get a nice view from the other side. So, Tasha has asked the interesting question about the lionesses. And at what age do the lionesses have their first cubs? So, Tasha, I have seen lionesses start mating from about 2.5, 3 years old. And if they are lucky, they will probably fall pregnant at the age of about 3, 3.5. Going to go up onto the dam wall, and we'll come back around and view her from that side. Oh, she is really posing for us nicely up in the on the open dam wall. Have a hippo in the dam, the one that I think you are all used to seeing. Not sure where the other one is, the younger hippo. I'm sure it's in there somewhere. Just gonna move a little bit closer to the female. Don't want to disturb it too much. Just a little bit more. Go. That's it. Wonderful, look at that. This morning when we had Mvula, that big male leopard, or that old male leopard, there was a question about the size of his tracks compared to a lioness's paws. And have a look at the size of the paws on that lioness. They are very, very big, much larger than a male leopard, and not nearly as big as a male lion, but the lioness's tracks are larger than a leopard's, or male leopard at least. Is very relaxed. So Cecilia in the UK has asked if this lioness, or if it looks like this lioness, has eaten recently. So Cecilia, it looks like it, but with those large nipples of the female, and with her lactating, she may look a little bit fuller than she actually is, but that belly does look quite big, so I do think she has eaten quite recently. And that's possibly also why there are a lot of tracks around this area. Maybe they did have a kill. We're not too far from Biffle's Hook. Maybe they had something to eat on that side, and they've come down to this water hole. It is a possibility. But yeah, she's definitely not hungry. That belly is fairly rounded, so it does look like she has eaten in the last day or so. And again, with this beautiful cool temperature now, I think that is why she decided to come out earlier. Come out to the waterhole, probably went and had a drink already, and then came and lay up on the dam wall. It's not hot, she doesn't have to lie in the shade. It's a perfect spot for her. In case something does come down to drink, she can maybe have a look and try her luck. But she is quite exposed here, so I don't think she would have any luck. You know, anything, and we spoke about it yesterday too, anything that comes down to water to drink, they are very alert, very aware, because they know when they put their heads down to drink, they are a little bit more vulnerable. So they're very careful, very cautious, just to make sure there are no predators around. We're going to sit here a little longer with this lioness, see what she gets up to. Why don't you go across to James and get an update from him and see what he's up to.
We are just basking in the glory of our sighting that we had earlier, and I'm out of the car because it's got a little chilly and I know that we're heading for home soon, so I'm going to put on my jugget. But I need to unplug myself in order to do that, and I will become almost immobile because I will resemble the Michelin Man. For those of you in northern climes, you would find the idea of putting an extra jacket on in temperatures like this utterly ridiculous. But for those of us who live out here, where anything below 20 degrees is considered utterly frigid, well, it's pretty normal. Brian, how many jackets have you got on?
Four.
Four jackets?
Four jackets. Only four this time.
It's probably 15 degrees or 16, so it's really not cold yet.
It's the wind.
It's a brutal wind. A brutal howling gale that we're experiencing here. Anyway.
How many jackets do you have on, James?
Two jackets.
Oh, and a scarf.
And a scarfie.
And a beanie.
And a beanie. And a blankie for my leggies. My little chicken leggies. Right, I feel very comfortable now, Brian. I might pass out on the way home. Here's my blankie. Okay, on we go. Very glad you've seen lions. You've now seen leopards, lions, elephants, zebras, buffalo, birds, the thumb. Don't forget the thumb, everyone. Right, we're going to make our way slowly back towards the west. Let's go one more turn past here. Hello, Joey. You say, I asked you earlier where you are in Australia. You say you're from southeast Queensland. Thank you very much for that. It's nice to know. And you say, could we see baby ostriches around here? Actually, Brian and I were just talking about baby ostriches. He was saying that the best ostrich sighting he ever had was in the Kalahari with baby ostriches. A male and a female, how many babies?
12 little chickens. So big.
12 little ones. The size of a Franklin. So they are around. Here, yeah, it's possible. We've seen a male and a female. We've seen them doing a bit of a courtship dance. So it's quite possible that they might come together at some stage. And maybe they will produce little babies around here. I mean, they have to have got here somehow. It's unlikely, but simply because we don't see them very often. But it's not impossible at all. So Joey, in southeast Queensland, I'm imagining you're about 10 hours in front of us. Could it be that much? Must be about 8 or 10 hours in front of us. Right, let's go up through here. 10 hours. That is a long time. So it is now. Of course, it's very late tomorrow, actually. Early tomorrow, sorry, in Queensland. And you're only 14 years old. Good grief, you have some very lenient parents allow you to be up at this time of the day. nothing else happening at the pan. I just thought we'd do one quick loop around here and see if anything had exploded out of the bushes, perhaps to eat those zebra, but nothing has. So we'll make our way gently and slowly back towards the west. Hello, Roger. Roger, you want to know about crocodiles, and you say in the rainy season, are the crocodiles, or is the water ever get high enough for the crocodiles to be in? Not really in these areas. You might find a crocodile once or twice in Biffleshook Dam, where Byron is sitting with that lion, when it gets full. But crocodiles tend to be fairly transient in areas like this. They like permanent water in a river. So they don't really like to live in dams. They will live in dams if they have to. At the reserve I used to work called Ngala, which is about 15 kilometers to the north of us, there used to be a pair of crocodiles that lived in an enormous dam there. But only that pair. There were never more than the two of them there. But that's not to say that they wouldn't come past. So I've often said this, I would never swim in something like Biffleshook Dam, no matter how many times I'd been there and never seen a crocodile, because crocodiles can often just come into an area for a couple of days and then leave, and you don't see them lurking below the surface of the water. And of course, to be attacked by a crocodile, I imagine, is a fate that couldn't really be matched by too many other horrible fates. So they can be around, but it's unlikely that we'll see them up here. Definitely if you go down towards the Sand River. Right, let's go back to Biffleshook Dam. The lion, I think, is asleep.
We are still sitting here with this lioness, and who is still resting very peacefully on the dam wall. Very comfortable, hasn't moved. Vim and I were just chatting, and we think there's definitely, well, there should be, and from the tracks we had this morning and yesterday, there should be at least two other lions in this area somewhere. So we're waiting, and hopefully they might come out a little bit later. No ostriches here either, James. I know James was chatting about ostriches. But none in this area that I've seen. Amazing. You think that lioness is completely fast asleep, but she is still very, very alert. Always aware of what's happening around them. So Cecilia has asked us, when a lion or lioness looks at you or looks directly into your eyes, does your heart skip a beat? Yes, it does. I mean, I think when any wild animal walks up too close and kind of gives you a look, then you do feel a little bit nervous and the heart does skip a beat. You know, at the end of the day, these are still wild animals. We are very fortunate that we're able to get reasonably close to them, and you never really know how they might react if they feel threatened. No animal is really dangerous unless they feel threatened, and unless you really push the boundaries too much. But they are wild animals, and you do still have to have a lot of respect for them. So Darlene from New Hampshire has asked a question about a pride of lions which are generally found in this kind of, well, south of here. They came from Londolozia. I'm not too sure when Darlene actually saw those lions. It's a Salala pride. And Darlene was saying that this Salala lioness gave birth to three cubs, but she has raised them or has kept them close to the pride and been moving them around with the pride. Now, Darlene wants to know, is that unusual, or how does that, or why does that occur? I think, Darlene, what often happens, and I'm not too sure what age those cubs are at the moment, but lionesses, when they do give birth, they do move off away from the pride, and I'm sure that lioness did too. She most likely found a den site, an area where she could hide the cubs, give birth to them. They are completely vulnerable when they are born. So the first 2 months, those cubs will be hidden in a den site, at least. And then what happens is once they reach 2.5 to 3 months, she will bring them out and introduce them to the pride. The reason for that is she wants the rest of the pride to get used to the cubs, and she will then allow them to stay around with the pride from then on. What will happen though is when the adult lionesses go off to hunt, they will hide the cubs in a thicket somewhere or in a safe area, and then they will then return, call the cubs, and take them to where that kill is so that they may also start feeding on some meat. So I think that's possibly what has happened there, Darlene. I don't think she would have given birth to them out in the open and had them with the pride from the beginning. Probably waited 2 months or so, and then she would have introduced them to the pride, which is very natural behavior for lions. It's interesting, when the lionesses do introduce cubs back to the pride, they are still very, very nervous and careful of the big dominant males. The males just generally can get a little bit aggressive at times, especially around a kill. So the lionesses are always wary. They, even though the males could be the father, they or are definitely the fathers, they're still careful, because if the males get a bit aggressive around a kill and swat a cub with a paw, those paws are so big and those lions are so powerful, they can easily kill a cub if they are not careful. So they just generally are cautious of the big males being around. Lioness just changing position there for a second, giving us her back. See, a grey heron has just taken off from a tree behind us, moving directly behind us. I don't think we'll see it, but probably a heron that frequents this waterhole or this dam. Beautiful big wingspan, very large wingspan of the grey heron. Flew off in that direction, directly behind us, off into the sunset. It's so nice sitting here close to this waterhole. The hippo hasn't moved, it's still in there. Relaxing, might leave the waterhole a little bit later this evening to go and feed. I'm almost certain it will. And hippo can cover quite a distance when they are looking for food, up to 5 or 10 kilometers in an evening if they have to. And there you see it's still lying in the water. Especially now in these drier times or drier conditions, they will have to cover a much larger distance to go and look for substantial grass to feed on. This lioness is lying with her head up at the moment, which is quite a good sign. You never know, she may decide to get up and move around a bit for us, walk off somewhere. Or put her head back down and rest some more. So hopefully James is heading back from Cheetah Plains and he hasn't got too lost down there. Why don't you go and get an update from him and see what he has, and we're going to sit here with this lioness for a bit longer.
Hello everybody. We haven't found anything alive, but we have found something dead, and of course I'm very homesick for my little tenty on quarantine clearings. There's a bone over there and it looks quite interesting. I'm just going to go and get it and see if I can identify what it is. Brian, you'll tell me if you see a lion coming bounding out of the bushes towards me, won't you?
Okay.
Thank you. Hmm. Now, this is not an insubstantially heavy piece of bone. That was a stump over which I tripped. Now, no, I don't know. I'm actually quite bad at this. This is from a giraffe, I'm going to guess. And I'm going to say that it is... I think that's the knee. What do you think, Brian? I think that's the knee joint, and I think this is probably there for the humerus, the front. Not the knee joint, it would have been... You see, this is where I get so deeply confused. If it's the front, everybody, I think this is the bit that goes down to the wrist joint, so it would be the radius and the ulna, and that would make sense, because that then would be the radius, and that would be the ulna. So you've got two bones in your forearm, the radius and the ulna. The thick one going to your thumb is the ulna, and the radius goes around towards your baby finger. And I think that's what this is, the equivalent of. There we are. And in the absence of a better idea of the anatomy of a giraffe, I'm going to say that's what it is. I've become rather fascinated with which bones are which and their sort of equivalence on our bodies and in the bodies of all other mammals. 270 bones, apparently, in the human body. And it's actually not that difficult to learn them all, because you've got two of most of them, so you can divide that in half already. So half of 270, Brian, is, of course, 135. And then, in some cases, you've got... You can sort of extract the eight or nine bones of the skull, so it's not so many there. You've got about 120. Then you've got five sort of odd little bones in your wrists and five odd little bones in your feet, so that takes another 10 out. And so we sit at about, well, I don't know, let's say 110 or so. And then the rest are really not too hard once you've got rid of the ribs and all of the cervical vertebra. At least all of the vertebrae in your spine, a couple in your arms, a couple in your legs, and your fingers and your toes, and suddenly you're at 110, and you feel like a doctor. Not quite. Do you get my drift? Oh, Tony. Tony, thank you for reminding us. Remember, Brian is now giggling. We found a skeleton of the Nyala that the lions had been eating. We called him Nigel, the Nyala. And Tony, you want to know what happened to him? I was trying to prepare him for our TV show. And by prepare him, I put him in a box full of flesh-eating beetles. And by the time the TV show came around, Tony, they had done a very poor job of cleaning him. And we had collected so many other bones that I thought, should I take it to Nigel with a scrubbing brush, some rubber gloves, and a sort of healthy dose of smelling salts, or just use what we have? And I decided on the latter, and I've left Nigel in the box full of flesh-eating beetles, and I hope that in the next month or so they will complete eating him, and then Nigel will make a return to the screen. Brian, you haven't posted your video yet. Brian put a, I don't know how many of you were watching, but when I picked up this, oh, hello, beefies. Some beefies next to us. We'll just have a quick say hi to them. They don't like the light, they get very nervous. So we'll leave them there. It's much lighter on your screen than it is in reality, everyone. So I'm just going to drive past them. We've got the big bright lights on the side of the car. So we had this Nyala, and before we came live with it, I was holding it, and Brian was and I was swinging it around. And then I was kind of doing a bit of a dance with it, and its mouth was flapping up and down like this, and it looks totally disembodied, and you don't even notice my hands. So Brian filmed this thing, and he's put it to music. And it looks like the Nyala's carcass is kind of dancing to the music. It's the most astoundingly, morbidly hilarious thing you'll ever see. So I'll try and persuade Brian to post it. Maybe you have to be there. Right, if we do lose you now, it's because we're leaving cheetah plains, but we should be all right for now. All I got was a beep there. Brian, did you hear anything? Just a beep. She beeping at us. You never know, everybody. You don't want to miss a communication. Tell she's a terrifying woman. She's got red hair, you know. Lack of soul. Lack of soul, no soul. But red do maybe have souls. Kirsten says she doesn't like me, so she'd like us to link across to Byron. So let's do that while we get up Cheetah Plains.
Look at this lioness. She's picked up her head and she's facing slightly west now. I heard lions calling. Oh, here we go. Listen, listen. Oh, fantastic. Incredible was that. As I was saying, there were lions calling in the distance, very faint call, but she picked up her head. She could hear it very clearly. She was obviously just returning a call. Not sure if it's part of her pride. Lionesses will also communicate and roar for territorial purposes, just like males do. So this is what an incredible sound. Probably the most amazing sound you can hear in the bush if you are close to a lion. Very deep roar, and it echoed across this dam which we are sitting at the moment. Such a great sound. Beautiful pinkish reddish orangey color in the sky at the moment in the background with the sun that has gone down. Look at that. What a scene. Lion roar, it does not get better than this. Wasn't that incredible? I understand James was showing you a bone that he found. I didn't think or realize he took up archaeology. This is very interesting. Fossils? I'll have to ask him about that later. I understand James thought it was from a giraffe. I hope he was right. We'll sit here for a few more minutes. Just watch this. And then she's picked up her head. And it is such a beautiful scene. Let's wait to see if she does move. Maybe we're lucky and we get another room. If there's a call from the distance again. You never know. James picking up. Bat activity here, look at that. The pressure is on this question about the lion and the lioness. She would like to have the nest, like house cats do. Tasha, do not. Lions and Arabic do not purr. The only cat which purrs a house cat or similar to a house cat is a cheetah, in fact. That is the only big cat which purrs. The voice box and that of the lion and of the leopard, they do not purr. They give this very deep roar which we just heard. So, but interesting question. Oh, there's a yawn, a beautiful yawn. Oh, another sound. That was just her breathing out. So Tasha, that was a good question because often people want to know. Another good yawn and stretch. There we go. which he decides to do. Right, everybody, sit still. She may walk right past us. Sounds like she's giving some low contact calls over there. Yep, there's another lion calling kind of southwest of where we are. And there she goes again. Amazing. Do you see how those muscles in her back tense up while she's roaring? They put so much effort into it. And it's incredible how far that sound can travel. Those other lions you heard sounded a lot closer. They seem to be heading in this direction. Possibly, and I'm almost certain they are communicating with each other, might be the rest of the pride. And maybe we're lucky and we get them meeting up. Let's see where this lioness is going. Just going to have a look quickly. Traverse. Incredible to hear a lion roar. Where has she gone? I've just lost her now for a second. There she is. There we go. VM spotted her. Thank you. Again, my multitasking is being tested here. I'll have to ask James for some more tips on this later too. There she goes. Seems to be heading in the opposite direction from those other calls that we heard. But then again, these lions, or lions in general, their communication is so much better than ours, and they're roaring. They definitely know how to pick each other up and which direction the calling is coming from. They're so accurate with pinpointing where the sound is coming from. Some Egyptian geese calling in the background, flying over the dam. Does that help a bit here? Getting a quick lesson on lighting here while we're following this beautiful lioness. Have a look while she's walking. She's constantly smelling. You know, their senses are very, very in tune to what's around them, and they can pick up any animals that have moved through the area in the last few hours, or any potential prey species. Their sense of smell is incredible. That roar was really, really phenomenal to hear, and I've been fortunate in the past. I've managed to see four big male lions, dominant male lions, lying in front of us and all roaring at the same time, and that is an incredible sound. The male lion roar is a little bit longer, a little bit deeper than the females, But if you often quite far from them, you've got to listen very carefully. It's not always easy to tell the difference. They do sound very different. I mean, very similar. And at a distance, it's hard to tell the difference. Michelle from New Jersey has asked us, or made a comment about this lioness, saying she wonders if this lioness could possibly move down into the drainage line close to the dam, which is perhaps where her den is. It could be, Michelle, but I think this lioness, well, what's happened now, she's actually moved away from that drainage line, so possibly heading off into an area where she could potentially go and hunt. That could be one reason, or try and just meet up with the rest of the pride if they are around. But perhaps she had come out of the drainage line, and that's why she was at the dam earlier. Amazing to be able to follow an animal like this. Don't want to get too close so that we don't disturb her. Just give her a bit of space. You can see she's not too fazed by us. When these animals, if they do look like a lion or leopard, doesn't matter what predator you're following, but if they do look like they are showing interest in potentially hunting some prey, we definitely back off, leave the lights off so that we don't disturb them or give their position away to the potential prey that they're trying to hunt. You know, as guides in this industry and showing people around and showing them the wilderness, we try and be as sensitive as possible, and we try not to interfere at all with the natural behavior of these predators or of any animal for that matter. We don't want to give one or the other an advantage. So JJ has asked a question, and he would like to know how dangerous this lioness is to me and to Via. So JJ, no animal, and not even this lioness at the moment, or while we are following her, no animal is really dangerous. They can become potentially dangerous, and the only time that happens is if we try and threaten them. All these animals view us as a potential threat. We look very strange. We're not something that they see very often out in these areas. So to them we look like another predator, but a strange predator. We walk on two legs, walk upright. So we do look very different and strange. So she is actually more afraid of us than we are of her. But if we force it and we try and get too close or threaten them, they will act in a way that is aggressive to protect themselves. That's the only time animals become dangerous. It's when they want to protect themselves. So no animal is dangerous as such, unless you try or you put yourself into a situation which could potentially become dangerous. Hope that answers your question, JJ. I just love this. This is fantastic. Being able to follow a lioness along a road, just myself and VM and the thousands of viewers around the world with us. It's incredible. Really, really incredible. So Heidi in Switzerland has just asked if we heard the other lions answering. There was just that one call, or two rather, Heidi, that we heard them vocalize and return the lioness's roar, but I have not heard them again. So. But they weren't too far, but I'm not sure if she, as I said, it doesn't look like she's heading in the direction which I actually heard the calls coming from. Those other calls sounded like they were coming from a southwesterly direction from where we were, but she seems to be heading more in an easterly direction now. So Juliet has asked a question about the lion's roar, and she would like to know if there is a pattern to the roar, or do they just roar? So Juliet, I think, if I understand the question correctly, you're trying to work out if there is a specific tone that they use, or if they... I'm trying to think how I can explain it, actually. It's quite difficult. I wouldn't say there's a specific pattern, but they do have a distinct sound, a distinct call that all lions sound like. It's unmistakable with anything else. So it is a roar, but to an extent it is a pattern that you can very easily recognize. But the interesting thing is, I do think that every lion has got a call which is slightly unique, and I think lions have the ability to determine which lions those are roaring, and they are able to recognize the voice or the call, the sound, and I think that's how they communicate with each other. I have seen male lions roaring on opposite sides of an area and run straight towards each other and know that they are brothers, that they are just meeting up with another dominant male, which is their brother, and they patrol an area together. So they definitely recognize each other's call. So, Marianne from Arkansas, I agree with you completely. It would be wonderful to see this lioness meeting up with her sisters or the rest of the pride. That really would be amazing to see. You never know. We could be lucky and we might see it. She's just drifting off through that thicket there now. Off the road. Again, they are able to pinpoint the sound of where the other lions are calling from. It's incredible how they can do it. With a bit of experience, you tend to get a bit better at pinpointing where the direction of lions come from, or where the lion's call comes from, but it's not always very easy. I'm just trying to see if we can find a gap through here. It's a bit thick there. See, the road still continues along. We can still follow her from this side. Multitasking while I try and follow this lioness. Why don't you head back to James for an update and a goodbye.
Nothing much to update, everybody. We've come back from Cheetah Plains. We're on Juma. It's been very pleasant indeed. What a drive we've had. And I'm so pleased that lion was calling. There's nothing, no better way to end the day than with a lion yelling into the darkness. Brilliant stuff. Now, I'm not sure if I'm supposed to say goodbye to you immediately, but until I get word, let's just keep searching for little things through here. We have seen nothing with the spotlight so far, I'm afraid. And Byron very kindly said that he was going to ask me about multitasking with the spotlight. I have got unquestionably the most unsuccessful spotlighting technique I've ever witnessed myself, so I think that's a bad idea. Jamie, of course, much better at multitasking, given her two X chromosomes and a generally large brain. So I think he'll have to wait to speak to Jamie to be able to multitask. There is a scrub here, which we are not going to disturb. It's a blindingly bright light. So I wonder, that lioness been lurking around Bivelshoek Dam for goodness knows how long now. Surely she must have cubs in that vicinity, unless she's the lioness from Torchwood and she's on her way back there. That's possible. but the Nkuhuma pride is very fragmented at the moment. And I'm pretty sure that's because they're all in the, well, not all of them, at least two of them are in the process of either giving birth or raising very little babies. And when they're about 6 weeks old, then they should be introduced to the rest of the pride. In which case, we hopefully will be able to see a bit more of them. All right, everybody, it's been a wonderful, wonderful afternoon. Thank you for coming along with Brian and I. We had a marvelous time, did we not, Brian?
We did indeed.
And there is the sun to say goodbye to you on this very cold Thursday or Friday evening. We'll see you tomorrow at 6 o'clock, 6.30. Until then, go and see Brian and hopefully the lioness. Bye-bye.
Right, everyone, so that lioness has just moved off through a thick area. We're unable to follow her any further. Maybe she's lucky and she meets up with the rest of the pride this evening. I'm sure they will at some stage. And we'll try again in the morning, come back into this area and see if we can't find, maybe they're out at the waterhole again or somewhere else close by. It's been a fantastic afternoon. Elephant, we had James the leopard and the zebra, and this beautiful lioness at the end. Really, really great day. It's been incredible. Hope you've all enjoyed it. Thank you to Via with me this afternoon. It was great. Hope you enjoyed it too, Via. And thank you to the ladies in the FC. Always a great help having you support us. And thank you to the viewers especially. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. It's been great having all your questions, and hopefully you've learnt a little bit along the way. Don't forget to join us tomorrow morning. It will be great to have you on Drive with us again. And thank you to James and Brian on the other vehicle. It's always great to be able to relay between James and myself. Have a wonderful evening, and we will catch you tomorrow morning. Good night, everybody, and thank you again.